There's an old adage in game design. Don't build anything most of your players will never experience. And while this once might have been good advice, the very way we experience games has changed. Thanks so much to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Click the link in the description below to see just how perfect Squarespace is for your next online idea. In the AAA world, you'll find a lot of games where if a player finishes it, air quotes, they've seen about 90%+ of the content. This is because, for a very long time, it was considered bad design to create things most of your players would miss. And this makes some sense. After all, every dollar, work hour, or resource you spend on building something that only 5% of your players will see could be spent on improving the experience for the other 95% of your players instead. But with the advent of the internet age, we no longer just experience the content we play. We experience the rumors floating around on forums, the videos of YouTubers finding crazy secrets, and the stories of all the wacky things that are happening at the highest level of play. These are real and legitimate experiences. And because of them, our full experience of our games are no longer limited to just what we get on a disc or the bits we download to our machines. And this is important, because it means that the stories of Eve Wars or the pages of speculation about Fortnite mysteries are content for a sizable portion of our player base. Far more than we'll actually ever get to pilot a great capital ship or unravel some brain-twisting ARG. But does that mean making high-end content, content that only a fraction of your players will ever play through, is worth it? This is a question James has been wrestling with a lot as a designer, and I think the answer is, sometimes. Even if you're worried about budget and resources, there are times where this type of content is the best spend for your game. So let's dig into when that's true. First off, it's never true unless your core game is solid. If you don't have a good base game, no one will be interested in all the amazing-seeming things you've locked behind 100 hours of dull stuff. If you've got the basics, though, then these aspirational game elements will come into play. So what do we mean by aspirational game elements? Well, they're the thing that keeps you playing because the idea of them is so cool. Just the possibility that you might get to experience such things in your game is exciting and fun. The most basic example of this comes from MMOs. If you've ever had that moment where a high-level player walks through town and you're like, "Oh my god, that is so cool, I want that heckin' mount so bad!" You've experienced aspirational play. Now, a slightly more involved example comes from Paradox Interactive. Building a Dyson Sphere in Stellaris isn't something that a player will get to do until they've played about 30 hours of that game. But the idea, the possibility of building that Dyson Sphere is so engaging that it might be what gets them to pick up the game in the first place. A different sort of aspirational play can be seen in Crusader Kings 2. At this point in its cycle, it's built to be a story generation machine. And hearing the stories of wild dynasties or reading internet tales of backstabbing kin is part of the Crusader Kings 2 experience. And those stories have probably sold more copies of the game than any advertisement Paradox has done. Even though really getting to experience that in gameplay requires a time commitment and a dedication to learning a huge number of complex systems that most players will probably never do. Perhaps even more importantly than sales, though, those aspirational aspects keep players playing. Daydreaming about building your Dyson Sphere while pushing around construction ships to build your 45th mining outpost is what gets you past the sections of the game that might drag a bit. And this is great for the player, for the designer, and, if you really care about it on a corporate side, for the company. Because it means people are sticking with your game long enough to actually buy the DLC. I mean, Crusader Kings is like from 2012, so you get what I'm talking about. And in a more personal example, I just recently told James about the secret floors under the regular Gungeon in Enter the Gungeon. This got him to instantly pick up the Switch version so he could play it on the go. Not because you'll actually ever have time to get through it, but because the possibility of doing so was so captivating. Just the idea that as the game unfolds, there's some unknown number of secrets and intriguing things hiding just below the surface was something he wanted to experience. It made playing the game feel exciting, even when he was just playing a basic run. Because now, everything was infused with a sense of possibility. And that brings us to the main point. When creating these sorts of aspirational game elements, they should focus on a sense of possibility and wonder. If you're going to create something that 5% of your audience will ever actually get to experience in-game, it can't just be a bigger weapon or armor with more stats. You need to be creating things that will give the players that never actually get to play with them something to dream about. Something that makes every aspect of the game, even the mundane parts, seem like they could be a portal to something magnificent and magical. These elements have to make the game feel like it's brimming with possibility so that actually playing with them becomes less important than knowing that they're there. And if you can do that, then through wikis, through videos on the internet, and through comments on Steam, a large part of your player base will experience them, and through doing so, change how they experience the rest of your game. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to go back into the gungeon for the umpteen billionth time on the off chance I can upgrade Sir Junkerton into a golden mech suit of justice while getting the spectral form so I can float across the chasm to reach the final piece for the bullet that can kill my past. Ah, oh, my dream. We'll see you next time. Once again, thanks so much to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Not only do they make it easy for our team at Extra Credits to share updates and have a clean and professional-looking website, but I've been using Squarespace for my personal online endeavors for years. And because I truly know nothing about web design, their awesome templates have helped my ideas look way cooler than they actually are for a while now. Plus, I can attest to their great 24/7 customer support as well. A few years ago, I was going in for an interview, and I needed to embed a piece of content to my site. I had no idea how to do it, and once I contacted them, we figured it out in like 10 minutes. And with domain transfers, online storefronts, and their all-in-one platform, which looks slick no matter where you view your content, there's no better place to make your next online dream a reality than Squarespace.